the axis.
One ABF, they're both positively deflected, you got a normal axis, and you didn't have to dive any deeper, I'm moving on. If my axis is not normal, I'm building down, trying to figure out why my axis is not normal.
But the quickest of the quick looks is to just do your thumbs up, thumbs down.
Okay, can y'all see that? One, an ABF. Both thumbs up, that's a normal axis. Look at the one, an ABF, thumbs up, you're good. We've already done these. Then we'll finish blocks. Okay. So we talked already about blocks in the AV node. There are blocks below the level of the AV node as well. Most commonly, a left bundle branch block or a right bundle branch block. Think of the bundle branches as the large branches of the conduction system. There are smaller branches that come off of them. Both the right ventricle and the left ventricle have very large branches, the right and left bundle branch blocks, which cover normal conduction pathways. The wiring contained in these branches can get frayed or broken, typically due to a prior MI or some form of structural heart disease. You can cause damage to the normal conduction pathways. In a right bundle branch block, the right bundle branch is essentially broken below the level of the bundle of disc, so it does not conduct electricity. Does that mean that the right ventricle does not get depolarized? The right ventricle has to get depolarized somewhere for it to be depolarized at all. Via the left ventricle. So the left ventricle is going to depolarize, and then through the ventricular septum, we'll see a vector of electricity flow through and depolarize the right ventricle. Same thing is true about the left bundle branch block, which is much larger, because the left ventricle is a much larger chamber. The left bundle branch as well can get broken, a big anterior wall MI, break off that left bundle branch block, and it's going to have to depolarize. Same way, electricity is going to flow down SA node, AV node, right bundle branch block is going to hook around, come through the ventricular septum, and depolarize the left ventricle. So the typical characteristics of your right and left bundle branch block. You look for bunny ears, and there's no sophisticated way to say it. You look for bunny ears. In V1, V2, look for bunny ears for a right bundle branch block. If you see bunny ears in V1 or V2 with a slurred S wave, you've got a bundle branch block, a right bundle branch block. Look for bunny ears in V5, V6 with negatively deflected V1, V2, V3. You're going to have a left bundle branch block. There's the morphology there on the screen in front of you. V1, you see the bunny ears, little r, medium size s, big r in V1, and the slurred s wave. That s wave is simply pushed open. It's a little bit broader than it normally would be near my bunny branch block. Left bundle branch block with V6, you see the little notching there. Those are your bunny ears on the left bundle branch block. Look at the EKG snipping into below it. You can see your negatively deflected complexes in V1, V3, and you got your bunny ears V4, V5, V6. Do you need to get bent out of shape? Do you need to get really worried in terms of pathophysiology about your right bundle branch wall? What's your instinct tell you?
No.
Not particularly. It's pretty common, too. There's a lot of guys walking around, particularly, with incomplete or complete right bundle branch walls. It's a smaller chamber. It depolarizes effectively through the ventricular septum. It's not a significant cause of disturbance. Left bundle branch block, is that a bigger issue? Potentially, yes. That may be an indicator of a big old anterior wall MI. That's a major electrical conduction pathway for the left ventricle. And you're going to end up with some ventricular dissymmetry in terms of the way the heart is beating and the heart is functioning. Over time, the depolarization via the right bundle branch block, via that interventricular septum, can cause, it's kind of like driving with this temporary sparing problem. It's not a good idea for your car to be out of balance like that all the time. So a left bundle branch block can cause some significant structural heart disease over time. But more importantly, from our perspective, in terms of cardiology, we look at that as, has this person had some significant damage to their heart muscle? Left bundle branch blocks are not a normal physiologic conduction pathway. Right bundle branch blocks might be. This is right bundle branch block. So look at V1. You see the bunny ears there in V1? that big enough for you to see? You're looking up, how do you stay? D1, little r, S, big R, slurred S wave. You see how broad that's kind of pushed open there in your QRS complex? Classic example of a right bundle branch block. Bunny ears in V1, bunny ears V2, slurred S wave, pushed open in D5, V6. Left bundle branch block pattern, a little bit harder to see in V6, I apologize, it's so small. Of course, you've got notching here, you've got bunny ears, your left bunny ear is actually a little bit bigger than your right bunny ear in this one. But you've got this wide, deep S complex, big S waves in B1, B2, and B3. Hemming block? Okay, here's where we're going to kind of drill down in some detail. The right bundle branch is one large branch that has filaments that come off of it, the Purkinje fibers. The left bundle branch bifurcates into two smaller branches. There's an anterior fascicle, or an anterior branch, and a posterior branch. Of the two that get damaged, the one that gets damaged more often of these two is the left anterior fascicle, the left anterior branch off of the left bundle branch. Particularly in a patient who's had an MI, you will see that left anterior branch, left anterior fascicle, getting broken along the conducting electricity. The typical pattern in that is if you have negative complexes, if you have 2, 3, and ABF, for left axis deviation, that's a left anterior fascicular block. What's my axis? Right or left? Good or bad? It's a left axis deviation. So you know it's not here, it's been pushed this way. What pushes? Scar or ischemia pushes, hypertrophy pulls. So you've got the breakdown of the conduction pattern. Something's happened to that left anterior fascicle. So push your axis around as the left ventricle is depolarizing, not via both the anterior and the posterior fascicles. This one's gone. So the left ventricle is depolarizing via the posterior fascicle off the left anterior branch block. So pulling your axis around this way. Does that make sense? As long as, I see no one sitting right here, that's probably a wise choice. You're in a little bit of danger right there, I think. Okay. This is another block that I wanted to talk with you about, simply because it's so dangerous to your patients and people don't take it seriously enough. When I was on rotation, on my psych rotation with a really great doc up in Ponca City, he had this iPhone, this cool little gizmo clipped on the back of it, it was two little electrodes. And every time he started to write for a psych med, he would hand the patient his phone. So he put your fingers on these two little electrodes and hold it out in front of you, and he would walk around, tap the screen. What lead was this little iPhone-based EKG reading? Lead one. What was it he was looking for? He was looking for something called the QT interval. From the beginning of the Q to the beginning of the T, this is depolarization and the beginning of repolarization. A lot of drugs will prolong the QT. Here's why that's dangerous. Here's, let me try and explain it to you in my visual learning terms. I'm talking about ocean waves coming in and out. Depolarization comes into the beach. Repolarization comes back out again. You've been sitting on a beach where you've seen two waves crash together, right? One's still coming back out from the beach, but another one comes in. What happens when they hit? There's chaos. There's a big spray. There's a huge splash. Same concept with electricity in your heart. If the heart is depolarizing and repolarizing in that rhythmic, nice rhythmic fashion, you don't have that overlap. If your heart is still repolarizing when the next wave of depolarization comes through, you can create electrical chaos because the positives and negatives slam into one another. You always want to make sure, mentally thinking, that your heart is fully repolarized before it depolarizes again. It's very difficult to get your heart to do repolarization, depolarization at the same time because it's not wired to do that. It's wired to protect us from that. But we, in our infinite wisdom, put people on drugs that prolong this phase and can create the opportunity for repolarization to overlap with depolarization. Anybody know what some of these drugs are?
Insulin.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
Hard drugs. Overdose.
Sure. Psych drugs? Anxiolytics? Cipro, lots of antibiotics that can lengthen your QT interval. You put a patient on who's on Zoloft, who's got a long QT, and they come in with a raging urinary tract infection to your unit, and you slap them on Cipro, and you jack their QT up to 550, and they die on your unit, it's on you. You've got to always look at the QT, calculated QT interval, before you start a patient on QT prolonging medications. Don't play around with it. You can kill somebody. That's why I love this doc in Ponca City so much. Because any time he started somebody on QT prolonging medication, he checked their single EKGs to make sure they didn't have a long QT. A lot of people do have congenitally long QT. Other people are already taking drugs that lengthen that QT out and put them at risk of dangerous, potentially fatal arrhythmias. But family practice, internal medicine, psych, hospital services, quite frequently, will start QT prolonging medication without first at least preparing the quality medication. My advice to you is, it ain't gonna hurt anything, get an EKG in. Even if it's just simple.
Since the QT interval varies with the rate, what number do you keep in your mind to say that QT is prolonged without carrying around a list of rate and QT intervals?
The computer calculates QTC, corrected QT, based on the patient's heart rate. I don't have to do it manually. The computer does that for me. Unless, of course,
and the computer will say this is prolonged QT.
It will. I always ignore the computer. I look at the QTC and I look at it myself.
So what number are you looking for with QT?
I look at 440 for men and 470 for women.
If it's longer than 440 for men,
you're prolonged.
They're correct. You're prolonged.
You're prolonged. Greater than 470 women, you're prolonged. You put somebody on a medication like Zoloft, you will see QT prolongation. It's normal on certain antiarrhythmic medications to see it. If it gets too long, their QTC starts getting too long, you've got to take them off those antiarrhythmic medications because it puts them more at risk of dying because of the drug than you are doing well by treating. You can iatrogenically cause them to have cardiac dysrhythmia that potentially fail. So in your QTC, your corrected QT interval that is rate dependent, the computer will tell you in the upper left hand corner what your QTC is, 453, 476, 513. It will tell you your calculated QT. You need to make a determination as to whether the patient is on any medication therapies that will be prolonging that QT, and if the therapies you're planning to put them on are appropriate and safe. 440 in a man, 470 in a woman. I would say women are tougher than men, they can tolerate more. It's less dangerous for a woman to have a longer QT than it is for a man. Men are not, we're not wired up as tough as women are. You need to perpetuate the species, we are largely. 450, 460, I use 440 and 470. Practice. You'll read different numbers in different places. Drugs can cause QT prolongation, hypocalcemia. That's going to cause QT prolongation, hypokalemia, hypothermia, acute MIs, congenital, increased intracranial pressures, and it can kill you. Okay, hypertrophy. Not going to belabor this point too much. Let's talk about atrial enlargement first. Normal P wave, you already talked about normal wave morphologies, and
yeah, but we didn't talk about any red atrial enlargement that'll come later in the month.
Perfect. I'm just going to touch on it here real quick. How many P waves do you see on an EKG? It's a trick question. How many P waves do you see on an EKG?
In one
PQRST. One. How many P waves do you see?
One.
Where's How many atria do you have?
Two.
Why do you only see one P wave? Because they're simultaneous. One's hiding behind. There are actually two P waves there, but one's hiding behind the other. So if one of them is enlarged, the summation of the vectors will cause a change in the dimensions of that P wave. If the summation is coming from enlargement of the right atrium, you get a tall, sort of witch's hat looking. Anyway, it sums early. It makes it tall. If you have left atrial enlargement, you'll actually get it shifting out of phase. So it'll be upside down for illustrative purposes. Your two P waves are right here normally. Your EKG is reading this way. So this is your right atrium, this is your left atrium, and they normally depolarize simultaneously. If you have left atrial enlargement, it kind of creeps out from behind the right atrial depolarization, the right sided P wave. So in right atrial enlargement, you get a witch's hat. In left atrial enlargement, you get them shifting out of phase with one another. And that other P wave kind of sneaks out, says hello. Left atrial enlargement. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
That's another really easy one too. You can really impress people with that one. The tall witch's hat P wave versus the camel's hump P wave. Right atrial enlargement, tall, summation of the vectors on the right side. Left atrial enlargement, that second P wave starts to creep out behind the first.
You mostly look at that in V1.
Yeah, that's a great place to bet. If you want to look at P waves, which leads are closest to your atria? Yeah, the ones that are up here. So that's a great place to look, is V1, V2. You can also look in lead 2, your standard monitoring lead on telemetry, you'll see it. But really the prime ones to look at, when you say, definitely V1. Right ventricular hypertrophy. Example of right ventricular hypertrophy. You can see how tall your R waves are in V1 and V2. Essentially, and if you look at, what's my axis? Let me ask you that first. What's my axis? Is one up or down?
Down.
Which means it's right or left?
Right.
Is AVF up or down?
Down.
Is that good or bad?
Bad.
So it's right bad. Right bad? Right bad. Okay. So this person's either got a big anterior wall MI and a big scar that's not conducting electricity, or they've got a lot of muscle on the right-hand side of the heart that's pulling that electrical axis around toward it. So a big right axis deviation like that, you may have right ventricular hypertrophy.
Can you explain real quick how AVF is considered down? Isn't that AVL though?
Isn't that the third? Yeah, shouldn't it be the third one?
This should be lead 2 down here.
Oh, sorry, lead 2's gone.
AVR, AVL, AVF, you're right. Sorry, my bad.
Yeah, I was like,
no, sorry, that's my bad. I'm just looking at lead 2. Yeah, so this is actually, this is right axis deviation, not extreme right axis deviation. I'm so used to, AVF is always right there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, thanks. So that's not extreme right axis, that's right axis deviation. It's still same concept though, just getting pulled around the right.
So see, he's calling that left upper quadrant extreme left axis.
Extreme right.
Extreme
axis.
Right axis. I call it indeterminate.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I call it axis indeterminate.
Yeah, it's got pulled way off to the right. But you're out right. Thank you for catching that.
The other thing that we've been introduced to is that a full 12-lead EKG, the very bottom line is only lead 2, and it's your rhythm strip that goes all the way across. And that's what he was thinking that was, because that's what he's used to looking at.
Yeah, so that's what you always see on the 12-lead EKG, is that bottom one is always your monitoring lead. So I got sloppy, and I didn't even bother looking at that. I just saw AVF and associated those two things together. I just assumed this was my monitoring lead. Not bad. Sorry. Left ventricular hypertrophy. LVH is a lot more common. Left axis deviation, big S wave in V1, big R wave in V5. What I like, did you talk about LVH yet?
Just a little bit. We just went over Preston's criteria.
Yeah. At a quick glance, the leads that I look at, just a quick glance for left ventricular hypertrophy. Quick glance here. How many boxes tall is this? Does this meet voltage criteria for LVH? How deep is this? How tall is this? My glance is AVL, V2, and V5. Yep, tall, deep, tall. You got tall, deep, tall, you got LVH. There are finer criteria, but if you want at a glance, that will tell you at a glance left ventricular hypertrophy. One of the things we get called on a lot in terms of consults from the emergency department is the patient is here and they have ST segment depression.
No.
Okay, we need a cardiology consult now. We get down there and they're a meth head, and they've been doing coke. They have chest pain because the cops tase them. Yes, I work at Sal. I'm halfway joking, but it's true. I got called for a consult one day, got down and talked to the patient. Having chest pain? Yeah. When did it start? Right, the cop tased me. One of the things that you will see on EKGs, you'll see ST segment depression, we're going to talk about here in a second, is an indicator of myocardial ischemia. But it also can be a pattern associated with left ventricular hypertrophy. So you'll see here this strain pattern where you get this classic check. How many of you are left-handed? One of you makes your check, two of you make your check marks in the opposite direction. Then. Maybe you don't. Look at the little left-handed check marks here. That's a clue that this is a strain pattern. If you see in the setting of left ventricular hypertrophy, it looks like a left-handed check mark. You know, the ST segment depression is probably due to what's called a strain pattern on EKG. It's not an indicator of myocardial ischemia. It's simply LVH strain. It's just an electrical pattern. You don't need to work your patient up for it, but you do need to get a study of this patient's heart because they have LVH on their EKG.
And they also have all the other characteristics of LVH.
Yes, they do. They check every single box for left ventricular hypertrophy. What study are you going to order for this patient? Echocardiogram, right heart cath, treadmill stress test. Echocardiogram for sure. Echocardiogram is the easiest, cheapest, quickest look for structural heart disease. It's going to tell you your chamber dimensions, it's going to tell you your valvular function, it's going to tell you your cardiac output. And that's the study we would do to look at the walls and chambers of the heart, so we look at LVH. Quick look at ischemia and infarction. You're going to drill down into this a lot more. The ST segment, which you've already been talking about, is elevated in an acute MI and depressed in ischemia. If you see ST segment elevation in contiguous leads on EKG, call somebody, let them know. They can lay eyes on it, get a specialist consult, and they can tell you whether that is what's called early repolarization or whether it's an indicator of myocardial ischemia. Regardless, if you've got ST segment elevation on EKG, please ask for an overread. You need to have a physician lay their eyes on it. You don't want to get caught out by calling something early repolarization when the patient's actually having a heart attack there on the table. Okay. ST segment is this little line between your QRS complex and your T wave. Not complicated. ST segment. What do we see in this EKG? Let's look at the ST segments. That's what I'm specifically asking us to look at. How do these ST segments line up relative to the PRI? And just draw an imaginary line through the PRIs all the way across, right? Are these ST segments elevated or depressed?
Depressed.
ST segment depression is an indicator of infarction or ischemia?
Ischemia.
Excellent. We're going to talk real quickly about distributions. This is going to be just gut memorization. Think about leads on an EKG as siblings. And there's one set of cousins on there. One and AVL are siblings. One and AVL both look at the lateral wall of the heart. What other two leads look at the lateral wall of the heart?
V5 and V6.
Always start with V5. One and AVL are brother and sister. Five and six are brother and sister. One and AVL, V5 and V6 are cousins. Why? Because one and AVL look at the high lateral portion of the heart. V5 and V6 look at the low lateral portion of the heart. They all look lateral, but one and AVL look high, V5 and V6 look low. Brothers and sisters, one and AVL, V5 and V6, cousins, V5 and V6, one and AVL. The next family grouping, 2-3 AVF. Talked about them already. That sibling group looks at what wall of the heart? They're looking at the inferior wall of the heart. 2-3 AVF, little family group, inferior wall. V1, V2, V3, V4.
sit right in front of the heart, yes? They're going to look at the anterior and septal portions of the heart. So we can localize ischemic and infarcted changes in the heart. If I say the patient has high lateral ischemia, what two leads am I looking at? One AVL. Anteroseptal MI. Inferior wall ischemia. 2-3 AVM. Low lateral infarction. Global left lateral ischemia. You get the picture though, right? So you want to see changes in families, not just in individual members of the family. If I see an isolated change in three only, I'm not going to call infarction or ischemia. I want to see changes in what other leads other than three, if I'm going to call something going on like inferior wall. Are the two leads do I want to talk about? 2-3 AVF make a family. So I want to see a change not just in one of those, I want to see it in that whole family if I'm going to call a significant change. If I see something happening anteroseptal, I don't want to just see a change in V1. An isolated change in V1 doesn't mean much to me. If I see it V1, V2, V3, V4, we have news. If I see it V5, V6, 1 AVL, we have news. Isolated change in one lead, in contiguous leads. That's the term that gets used for these. These family groupings are referred to as contiguous leads. 1 in AVL, V5 and V6, lateral. Inferior, 2-3 AVF. Anteroseptal, V1, V2, anterior, septal, V3, V4. Those are your family groups. Look for changes in family groups.
Sorry, I just missed one part important. So, one AVL will get the superior lateral wall.
High lateral.
Okay.
I call it high lateral.
Okay.
High lateral, low lateral.
Okay.
Yep. Or, more gentlemen, just say lateral. It's kind of splitting hairs. So, do we see changes in contiguous leads on this EKG? Where do we see ST segment depression on this EKG? 2-3 AVF. Is that significant?
Yes.
Is that a family group?
Yes.
What wall is it looking at?
Inferior.
Which ventricle is it looking at?
The right ventricle.
Right ventricle. Right ventricle. Inferior wall mirror, right ventricle. Where else do we see EKG changes? ST segment looks good here. It's good here. Okay, here. Whoa, oops. Hang on. What's going on here?
V4, 5, and 6.
How would you call that on? How would you describe that to somebody? Inferior wall ischemia and? Maybe anterolateral ischemia. Patient has an abnormal EKG. Underlying normal sinus rhythm with acute STT changes in 2-3 AVF. V4, V5, V6, indicative of inferior wall and anterolateral ischemia. It's a lot to chew on. We just covered a lot of ground. But you're going to remember those families, aren't you? You're going to, yeah. 1 AVF, 5 and V6, 2-3 AVF, sibling group, inferior wall. Anteroseptal, V1, V2, inferior septal, V3, V4. 1 AVL. Okay, we're good? Thanks. I don't know how to get that down. Okay.
It's good.
We'll keep mushing. ST segment elevation. Okay. Is that an ugly looking EKG?
It's ugly.
My patient does not feel very well. My patient presented to the emergency department with
crushing chest
pain.
You hear what he said? Is that ugly? Pretty or ugly, right?
Yeah. He's
dealing with it. All that stuff at the first, you know, the rate, the rhythm, and the axis, the computer can do better than us because it's numbers.
Oh, sure.
But this, we do better than the computer
absolutely.
By far.
Every time.
Because we're looking for a pretty picture or ugly picture.
Absolutely right. And this one's ugly. Mucho ugly. And I see ST segment elevation. Do you?
Yeah.
Where do we see ST segment elevation?
V1, V2,
V3. V4, V5, V6. Yeah. Do we see some ST segment depression? Depression. There's some elevation here. Holy smokes.
That's a big MI, isn't it?
Yes.
Okay, let's talk about where this MI is. V1 and V2, anterior. V3, V4, septal. V1, V2, anterior, V3, V4, septal. So this is anterior septal. Anywhere else?
So I have a question. What I taught them was that in this EKG, V1 and V2 would most likely be MI. That MIs on 12-lead EKG are defined by Q waves. And that what you've got here in V3, V4, V5, and V6 is injury pattern. Now, who knows? It's big. Whatever ischemic is a big area.
Mm-hmm.
But do you interpret 12-lead EKG as infarction just because the ST segment's convex or elevated?
This is going to buy them a trip to the cath lab.
It's going to buy them a troponin.
It's going to buy them a cath lab.
As a 12-lead EKG, it doesn't define infarction.
Right. I'm going to call this as a STEMI.
That's an important term, STEMI. Is a clinical term, meaning you better do something about this right away.
Right.
What does it stand for?
ST segment elevation myocardial infarction. Patient's having an acute.
We don't know this is an infarction until we get the troponin back or we do a cath.
But this buys you.
You've got to do that fast. We've got to do it quick because it's time dependent.
Yep.
But if all you're talking about is 12-lead interpretation, you're a little more conservative.
True. Typically, when we're going from the ED to the cath lab, we'll call STEMI. And don't have to call specificity on the STEMI. You won't make the call necessarily until you get in there and get a little dye into each vessel and you see actually which is your culprit vessel.
And STEMI is a term, I think. STEMI was a term that was created probably sometime in the 80s, 1980s, because an intervention became available. And so you needed a reason to look at an EKG in the ER and say, we've got to go to the cath lab now. This is the one. This is the one that says, you've got to go to the cath lab now.
Absolutely.
And the thing that's scary about it are those ST segments in V1 through V6.
Yes, no question. This person's got a large area of ischemia, and you see some reciprocal changes also in the inferior leads. This patient is very, very sick. This is an acute MI that's going to buy him a trip to the cath lab within a very specific amount of time. So when you're working on your ED rotation, somebody comes in saying, I have chest pain, one of the first things you're going to do is you get them back to triage, you're going to get them EKG, and you're going to lay eyes on that EKG as fast as you can. And that's actually a really cool place for you to step in and help out in the emergency department, because you will know EKG interpretation well enough that you can lay eyes on it, ignoring what the computer tells you. You look at it yourself, and you can see whether there's ST segment elevation anywhere. ST segment elevation sets in the process, a series of steps that you have to take in handling a chest pain patient with an abnormal EKG. They have to get to the cath lab during needle time, during balloon time, or specified by guidelines.
You have to go over again about reciprocal changes, because I don't think that they understand that. That's the first time they've heard that term, if they caught it at all.
Yeah. Reciprocal change is going to be when you have ST segment elevation somewhere, you will typically see an ST segment depression elsewhere, an injury.
Is it the opposite side of the heart? Usually?
So the elevation is in the anterior leads, the depression is in the inferior leads. They're reciprocal. Anterior, inferior. Or posterior.
Yeah.
We would see them posteriorly if we had a lead on the back.
Which we don't. Which you can do, but reciprocal changes.
Changes.
Yeah. So ST segment depression offsetting the ST segment elevation in your anterior and internal lateral leads. All right, let's look at this one. We have an EKG.
you have, do you have ST segment elevation info?
Yes.
What leads do you have ST segment elevation in?
2, 3.
2, 3. AVF, what distribution is that?
Inferior.
What blood vessel supplies the inferior wall of the heart?
Oh boy.
You're working your way through the CERC, the LAT, I don't know, the Ramus Intermedius. Tell me. So 2-3 AVF, you've got ST segment elevation. That's an ugly ST segment elevation. It's getting pretty tall. Do you have reciprocal change anywhere? We'll just skip right to reciprocal change. Do you have reciprocal changes anywhere?
Yes.
Where?
D2, D3. Are those bunny ears? I don't know, on D2 or 3 or...
No, I don't see any bundle branch block pattern there. But.
You would think that. That's
the
little
end, though.
It's just the ST.
Are you talking about here?
No, I'm talking about three.
Lead three?
Yes.
Oh Lord, that's ST segment elevation. So, think of it as the T wave and it grabbing it. And what electrolyte fuels the T wave?
Potassium.
So think of potassium leaking. Potassium is leaking and grabbing that segment and hauling it up into the air. It's alarmed. Potassium is leaking out all over the place. It's dragging that ST segment up in the air. So you've got this indicator of damage to the myocyte, and it's dragging that segment up in the air. So that is your T wave here. What is the first and most acute indicator of an MI happening? What's the first thing you see? If you're watching somebody, I'm watching his EKG. We've got an EKG right now, and he starts having a heart attack.
T-wave on the flip.
T-wave is actually going to get peep. T-wave is going to start to get peep.
Before it flips?
Before it flips.
Before
it flips, it's going to start to get peep. That potassium starts to leak out. And it starts to pull that up with you. First thing you see is T-wave.
Do you see inverted T-waves a lot when there is ischemia or even... like there was injury, but they got it fixed, and
yeah.
Then it will flip back.
Yeah. Eventually. So let's say someone came in with a big anterior wall MI. They've got a stent. So they had a big heart attack. They've got a stent, and you do an EKG on them. They come in clinic a week later. Oh my gosh, your T waves have flipped, and
but it's just healing.
Yeah, post ischemic changes, and you'll see things like Q waves on EKG also. Q waves are an indicator of an old MI. Yeah, so there will be post-MI changes. These are all acute changes that are happening during the course of a leaky heart attack. This patient's having a big inferior wall MI. Looks like some lateral injury as well. And they've definitely got reciprocal changes in bone and ADL. So big inferior wall MI, culprit arteries, probably your RCA. But what's this? Mm-hmm. If this patient shows up in your ED and you pull this EKG, where are you going to send them? You're in Antlers.
You're gonna fly a helicopter.
You're gonna fly to the world. If you can get them to a PCI-able facility within an allotted amount of time, you can send them. Your other option.
Now the weather's bad.
No, exactly. I know your fixed wings grounded, your rotary wings grounded, your bud's tussle. What's your best option? You mentioned TPA. You mentioned TPA.
TPA.
TPA. Yeah, clotbuster. That's what we used to do. Okay. What's your diagnosis on this one? Do you see an abnormal EKG? Where do you see ST segment changes in this EKG?
One.
Yes.
ABO.
Yes. Are those siblings?
Yes.
Look at their cousins. V5 and V6, are they ugly?
Yes.
So, where, and do you see reciprocal changes anywhere?
Three.
Do you see ST segment depression in your anterior septal leads and also in your inferior leads? What would you call this if you were calling your attending at 2 a.m.?
I don't know.
Ugly. I have an ugly EKG. ST segment elevation is an indicator of ischemia or infarction. Uh-huh.
Which? Just a second. Elevation is an indicator of infarction. You are having a freaking heart attack.
But the EKG doesn't show until there's a Q wave.
This is, yeah. Well, yeah, I get where he's going with it. It's an acute injury pattern.
There you go.
Ischemic injury.
There you go.
The heart attack, the scar.
And you better get to the cath lab.
The scar develops and gives you a Q wave. So you have a Q wave and an I. Your acute injury pattern is the ST segment elevation. So we'll call it injury.
Yeah, so what you're hearing this ambiguity that I talked about yesterday. For 35 years. Clinical medicine is practiced with and taught with a remarkable ambiguity of vocabulary. You're looking at a man who practices cardiology. He sees these patients in the ER, and his brain is thinking, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? And when he sees this ugly EKG, he says, this person's having a goddamn heart attack. I'm taking him to the OR. I'm taking him to the cath lab. If I'm sitting in the EKG station 3 days from now, and I get this EKG to read, I'm saying there's injury pattern all over the place. I don't see any infarcts. But if I was seeing the patient with him in the ED, I got to think infarct. You see what the difference is?
Injury and infarct. The injury is acute. You catch it in time, you're not going to have
an infarct, a Q wave.
Yeah, you're not going to have the Q wave. You're not going to have that scar on the heart if you catch it fast.
That's so why the term STEMI got invented. Because there was all of a sudden something we could do. Until the mid-80s, there wasn't anything we could do. They were just right. Having a heart attack, and that's it.
Yeah.
But as soon as there was something we could do, we had to think differently about the diagnostic test.
Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah. This person is in the process of a heart attack happening. It's the injury phase of the heart attack happening, not the scarring part. The actual infarction. Infarction is dead tissue, right?
Right.
It's not dead yet.
If we act soon enough,
yes.
We might be able to avoid the Q wave infarct.
Yes, that's absolutely correct. This is the heart muscle dying. It is not dead yet. Infarcted tissue is dead. It is in the process of becoming dead, but it ain't dead yet. Let's save it. So let's get them to the cath lab and do something about it. Yes. This is the injury pattern of an MI that is happening. It has not happened. Let's catch it. But we can tell you where it is. One, AVL, V5, V6, which blood vessel? This is going to be knock it out of the park. This is going to be Boston Red Sox against the Yankees last night. Okay. You get three big blood vessels on the heart. RCA supplies the inferior wall, LAD supplies the anterior wall, circumflex is the
lateral.
Yes.
That's right.
Yeah, those are just norms. Everybody's anatomy is a little bit different, but in general, RCA, LAD, circ. So in all probability, when you get this person with a cath lab, your culprit lesion is probably going to be either in the LAD or more likely in the circ.
Didn't I say that? I said LAD. And you told me to show up.
More likely in the circ.
Maybe a foul ball.
Yeah, it may be in the LAD, but I'll bet you lunch it's in the circ.
Can I ask something about, so I didn't realize that all my time of series, so... Let's say we're doing this, they're off the treadmill, doing a stress test, and we're going to take them off, but now they're doing nuclear medicine. They're doing nuclear medicine. Would that show up as dead tissue? Or not yet?
Okay. Cool question, yes. All right. Let me tell you something called a viability study.
It's just personal.
Like,
they don't know.
No, but this is actually really pretty cool. Okay. So,
repeat the question.
Hit the question.
Okay, so nuclear medicine, they're going to light up the heart with everything that's functioning, and it looks like a donut. It's pretty cool. But I always thought if they were already in the STEMI, that tissue's going to I guess, dying or dead, so it wouldn't show up as a complete donut. It would show that that tissue is forever.
On a nuclear perfusion scan, it shows you two things. It shows you reversible defects, which are areas of ischemia, and it shows you scar, which are fixed defects. So you get a stress test report back, they'll say, I come into your clinic, and I'm having chest pain every time I go out and cut the grass. And I push the lawnmower for a few minutes, oh, I start to get this crushing chest pain. We need to do a stress test on you. I get sent into nuclear medicine, they do a stress test on me. They give me a little bit of technetium-99 cestamibi, they scan my heart with a single photon emission CT scanner, they get a resting picture. That is my, there's my heart at rest, not under stress. It lights up nice and bright all over, nice hot orange yellow all over the place, nice and clear. They put me on a treadmill. They walked me for 12 minutes on this awful protocol called the Bruce protocol. And at peak exercise, they give me some more technetium cestamibi. They put me back under the scanner, and this time when they scan it, I get this big shadowy area that doesn't light up very bright in the inferior portion of that donut. That is reversible ischemia. It's not there at rest, but appears with stress. That means it's something we can fix.
Okay.
If you do the imaging of my heart at rest, and it's got this big dark spot at rest, it's got the same big dark spot at stress, it's not reversible. It's a fixed defect that is indicative of scar. Scar is old heart attack. Ischemia is
new.
Ischemia.
Not necessarily heart attack.
Good blood flow, but that is reversible. It is fixable. So if you were to stress test this person in the middle of this heart attack, you would find a reversible defect. But you might not do that. Because stress testing people would be so awful.
Yeah, right.
You're sending them a patient who's in the middle of a heart attack. Yeah, you can't do this. You got to send them to cath lab. Because you've got elevated troponin, you've got EKG changes, you're not going to go to a stress test. You're going straight to the cath lab. If the patient comes in to your emergency department and you don't have these EKG changes, but they're having chest pain, your troponins, your enzymes are a little bit bumped, and you're curious about what's going on. You want to see if this actually is ischemic. Then they get the stress test. They do not go straight to the cath lab. This person, straight to the cath lab, because they have acute ischemic changes on their EKG. In this case, ST segment elevation is the acute ischemic change, the acute injury change on the EKG. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. I just need like a visual.
I'm all about
that. So if you had that person that had the dead tissue already at rest and exercise on their EKG, you would see that Q wave, right?
You would see the Q wave.
Okay. But no. But that's
all
danger.
Yeah. Here's the trick with Q waves. It depends on how big the MI was. Is it a full thickness MI? Did it kill off all the heart muscle tissue? Or did it just leave a little superficial scar? Little superficial scars, little heart attacks, very often don't produce Q waves. The bigger and uglier the heart attack, the more transmural, that's the term we used to use, is non-transmural MI versus transmural MI. Non-transmural, typically no Q wave, transmural, full thickness, big ugly one, lots of scar, Q wave. Yeah. This person, you can say, needs to go to the cath lab, they're having acute ischemic changes indicative of a heart attack in the process. We're going to go to the cath lab to get them fixed. Another one. We've got a couple more minutes left. Let's keep playing. Is this one ugly or pretty? Tombstones. I heard my favorite word. Pizza. It's tombstones. Where do we see tombstones?
The cemetery.
I see tombstones in 2-3 AVF for sure. You with me on that?
Yeah.
You see reciprocal changes in your anterior leads?
AVF.
I don't know.
V1, is it down? ST segment down?
Yes.
V2, ST segment down?
Yes.
V3, ST segment down?
Yes.
V4, ST segment down?
Yes.
Those are changes. Works for me. Where's this person going to go? Stress testing?
No.
All?
No.
Cath lab.
Cath lab, yeah. We're having a what wall?
Injury.
Inferior wall. What blood vessel?
Right
coronary. Bang, you got it.
Look at
the other.
Well,
let me take the testing.
Let me see here. Let me see here.
Brady Cardi.
Flip there. Flip T waves. You got an injury pattern there. It's ischemic changes. But what else do we see? Do you see any P waves before each QRS couple left?
No.
Slow.
And what's your rate?
Really slow. 300.
What's the intrinsic rate of the SA node? 60 to 100. What's the intrinsic rate of the AV node? 40 to 60. What's the intrinsic rate of the ventricle? Right. And what's the rate here? 300, 150, 175, 60, 50.
25.
Yeah,
30-ish. So
it's a little bit slow. Ooh, that's a good question. Does this person get a pacemaker?
Yes, no.
Why are you shaking your head no?
I have no idea.
I like that answer. What if this patient is taking verapamil and metoprolol?
Well, after all the history.
Yeah. Hey, don't slap the pacemaker on everybody. Take off your beta blocker, your calcium channel blocker. Let me double down on a beta blocker last night. But you don't get upset because the kids are misbehaving. So. You'll see people do crazy stuff with their medications. Okay. Some EP oddities, and then we'll be done. We'll just cover these in a couple of minutes because these are kind of fun. Wellens, one of my favorites. Look at your T waves in your anterior, particularly anterior, well, V1 through V3. Do those look like normal T waves? I'm going to point at things, and you tell me when I get to a T wave. Okay, is that a T wave?
No.
Is that a T wave?
No.
Is that a T wave?
No.
Yes.
Funky looking, isn't it? Does it do this? Is it biphasic? Is it both up and down?
Yes.
Both up and down. Biphasic T waves in your anterior septal leads are an indicator of something called a widowmaker.
LAD.
Proximal LAD lesion.
Yes.
Proximal LAD lesion.
I want to change my answer from the other question to this one.
Hey, we have a winner!
Yeah.
Oh, that Grand Slam home run there. What was the 8th? Oh, it wasn't the Yankees, Lewis. Okay, next one. Old Parkinson White.
Oh, yeah. I thought that. It's like when they pass out.
Like they
heart
flutters
and then
pass out.
Or
die. Is that not it? Oh, yeah. Because they have horrible palpitations.
Yeah, the student had it, and then she would pass out in Dr. McNeil's lectures.
Maybe she didn't. Sorry,
Mac, I don't feel well.
And she tried to get a something where they, like, try to
do an EP study. Okay, so let's start something that's structurally normal. Heart, there's only one gateway from the atria to the ventricles. In Wolf Parkinson White, there's an accessory pathway that goes around the governor node function of the AV node, and you can end up with these really nasty tachycardias because it bypasses the AV node. And the distinctive sign of Wolf Parkinson White is that you don't have a normal PRI. Look at the data here. From the P wave, do you have a nice flat PRI where the governor node, where the AV node is holding on to it before it passes that ball along? Mm-hmm. It ramps up, and it's called a delta wave takeoff through the QRS complex. So the AV node is not doing its job. It's going around the AV node, bypassing that normal pause that allows for ventricular filling. And you can potentially get some very rapid rates due to cycling through that accessory pathway. Wolf Parkinson White, something you should watch out for if you ever see a delta wave takeoff. If you ever see that short PRI with that quick angular delta takeoff, think Wolf Parkinson White. Get into an EP.
Is it so that's you passing the volleyball over your head to?
Well, yeah, you can, and with the Wolf Parkinson White, because you got an accessory pathway, you end up with this doubling of the rate. So let's say I've got the ball, I'm the AV node getting the ball from the SA node, and I'm passing off the ventricle. I'm getting that, I'm splitting into two balls, I'm passing one here, I'm passing another one back around and down again. So whatever I'm getting from up here, if it's coming at me at 100, I'm doubling it through my accessory pathway and giving a ventricular rate of 200. Because it can loop back around through that accessory pathway. You get AV node reentry tachycardias and accessory pathway tachycardias looping back through, running back through the AV node again. So you end up with basically a doubling of your rate.
What's the difference between that and
bundle branch blocks are where the wiring is broken off,
This is a whole installation between the atrium and the ventricle, so you've got an extra path of electricity to flow through.
On the EKG, you pick this up with a short PR interval, even if there's not a delta wave. There may be a delta wave, but the short PR interval, what I call pre-excitation syndrome, this is one of the pre-excitation syndrome.
Well, I just looked at the QRS solid.
No, don't worry about the QRS complex. It's why, because of the delta takeoff, which is happened upon the delta part. Last
so
one.
So can that be in any of the leads, or is it specifically D6?
It can be in any of your leads. Just look for that delta takeoff. If you see the delta takeoff, number one, look for the short PRI. If you see a short PRI with the delta takeoff, send them to a cardiac electrophysiologist for workup. We're having palpitations. Last thing, just going to mention it to you. Anybody know that guy's name?
No.
Don't break my heart.
Salvador Dali?
No, I didn't.
I heard it. Who said it? Thank you. Somebody knows their artist, Salvador Dali. He had this really distinctive mustache. And if you have a ditch overdose, you get that distinctive hook in your SDT. All right. That was a ton of material to cover. We're going to have some regatta. Regatta is something you can do on your own. I'll cover it for you. It's very rare. It's fascinating. But in EKGs, as in everything in medicine, you can hear those. I think horses, not zebras. I know you've got a million questions.
He will be sending his PowerPoint to me, and I'm going to add it to D2L. It will be in addition to the one you already have, but I'll label it. It will be the same position right under his, and then it will say also updated.
Sorry about that. I just realized that. Other questions?